About CLIL, Content and Language Integrated Learning. But these are also issues which impact on any approach. And one is now direct translation. And especially for those FETs now coming into Taiwan for the first time, what must you do? How must you go about it? I'm going to tell you later on what I did. But I would like to hear from the more experienced FETs working in Taiwan for quite a few years. What is your experience of an English lesson, and where and how does Chinese come in? Anyone? Yes.
Yeah. Well, at first you don't know. When you get here, you know you're not. What I was thinking, but obviously they don't understand this, especially teaching younger kids. There are many ways they don't know. So when I first arrived, I also started learning Chinese. So I just applied what my Chinese teacher told me is to, if I don't know the word for sunglasses, I will try to use the words that I know to describe that thing. So it's a thing that you put on your face when it's sunny, you know, so and then they get to recycle their already existing vocabulary to make the new word. And I find that they also then memorize that word better. But I've been lucky at my school. I don't have a Taiwanese teacher. I only teach the English or talk the English. So all the mistakes that they make are my responsibility. So I've had very little of that kind of, but I taught in Bushibang, so I was getting all the English taught at the elementary school that wasn't that great, came to the Bushibang, and I had to undo all of that. Where kids, but as you get to learn Mandarin, you can anticipate the grammar and the pronunciation mistakes. And then, so when I introduce a new a phonic sound or something that I know that they'll have issues with, you over-pronounce and over-accentuate that. So, again, the direct translation, I try to encourage them to use other words that they, if they really can't get it, then the teacher can speak Chinese, and then they're allowed to say as few words as possible to explain what they want and what they want to say.
Do you find, Mia, in your classes that quite a bit of Chinese is spoken?
Oh, of Chinese.
Also by the co-teacher?
Yes. So, in the beginning, it's very hard, it's that dance that you're going to do with the co-teacher, because you don't want to take away any of the authority, and it's a very difficult thing. So, in the end, what the agreement that we came to was that discipline, be quiet, can be done in English, but real hard talking to you can be done in Chinese. But to try to make the class time and everything that happens in class 90% English, if we can, you know, but that's the perfect word.
That's a tall figure, no.
Yes.
If I can paraphrase your question first, when is direct translation brought into the classroom, into my classroom as an English teacher? Never. That's my answer. Are there exceptions? I don't want there to be, but I never want Chinese in my classroom, ever. From my co-teacher, because I can act out what I need, I can draw pictures of what I need, I can find new ways to present my ideas in English or in song or in emotion or whatever. I never want Chinese in the classroom. I'm not prejudiced.
No,
I want Chinese.
No. That's one approach. Yes. Sorry, your name, sir?
I found it really useful when there's instances like wits, like Mandarin, you say, I play ball. But I don't play with the ball. Showing how they're changing their Chinese to English, and it's not successful, but it builds up the same, and then take that advantage and take the opportunity to learn the word with and spend time on it and see why it's needed and necessary. So, yeah, otherwise,
did have a Taiwanese co teacher, and if there was anything to be said, she did it. It took about 30%, I would say, to be honest, of the classroom, 30% to explain things, especially if the students were younger, or if they didn't have as much exposure as the students who could go to a bush event. The situation where I had my own classroom, I was in the class myself, and I was teaching very rural students, and there was much more Chinese because the students had no, many students had no English, and they had no, I would use pictures and things, but just to make it clear and make it quicker, because things would take a lot longer, I did use about 40% Chinese with me directly speaking to the students, but that was the agreement of the principal, and the students did do well in that type of situation because they didn't know where to start with. They were very confused about what my expectations are as a foreign teacher because they had the Confucian style of teaching, and I taught Socratic style, and just so they could understand my expectations, what I need you to do, what I need you to look for, those directions would be given in Chinese, and then we get into the lessons, and the lesson would be in English after they understood what their goals were and what my expectations were of them for each lesson.
Thank you.
Yes.
Yeah. With my situation, we have 2 periods per week, and I do the second period with the kids, where we follow up and I reinforce the activities. So the Chinese is already out of the way when I come to teach kids. It's used only when we have sort of difficult or complicated instructions to give the kids, or in situations where the co-teacher feels that they need some more explanation or, but general policy is that we try to use as little Chinese as possible. And with my English Eagles and English Hawks, particularly the Eagles, we don't use Chinese. We don't. And when the English Hawks have learned the content, that's it. We don't need any more Chinese.
And the Hawks, the lower level?
The lower level, yeah. So once they've got the information, the content in Chinese, then they know the English, they're expected to use the English then.
Right. Any other comments? Ideas?
Every year is different. That's the wonderful thing about this situation here. But the last teaching situation I was in, I introduced maybe 30 basic vocabulary phrases that you want to use in the classroom, open your books, and I go to the bathroom, da, 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 da. And with those, you can download so much from clip art or to draw. You have the graphic, and then you get involved in the body language, so you work out a series of activities for them to master that. Then I do my first and only test of the year, and that is to just evaluate that part. Then I look at the scores, and this is where it's crucial to have your own classroom, because after the evaluation and all that, all those flashcards and that are kept, you know, on the wall where they can see, you know, open the door and it's open the door and words that are Chinese. But what I get from the evaluation I use to set up my grouping. And I find now that about 6 groups is optimal, because if you're working with a class of 30 kids, that's about 5 per group. And that's sort of controllable. But then when I look at the evaluations, which I have given, nobody else has touched, da, 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 I will take the high kids and put in each group 1 high kid and 1 low kid. And then the rest I don't worry about. And they help each other out. And it works quite well that way. Everybody has their own system, but it's very manageable. And so, sometimes, a slower student is having some trouble, they might have, say, they're Chinese, but nobody necessarily hears it, I'm not doing it, but it just, because you've got to always make sure that you don't lose the lower ones. Where they hit the frustration wall and get angry and just turn off. And this is one way of doing it. What happens then is you get discipline problems, you get a whole slew of other problems. Yeah.
I also make sure the groups are still that voice and voice as well.
But it's great to have your own classroom.
Yeah, for sure. Yes.
I just want to add one thing. Today, when Min was teaching us today, remember how she started out saying, use a little English right now, but after this, I'm not going to speak any more English, right? And she didn't.
No.
And we didn't need it. And I sure as heck didn't know any Chinese, you know? We didn't need it. And this is so it was kind of an inspiration to see you perform today, because, for me, because we, it's what I try to do in class, this similar thing, is using gestures, and you were using hand signals like this and this, and whatever, this, whatever these crazy things.
Yeah, okay. Actually, I think it's much easier for a language instructor, you just stay with one language.
Yes.
You just try to go back. Yeah. I'm not that kind of person, you know, I cannot, you know, speak a little bit Chinese here and a little English there. And then kids need more time to process, so if you're only feeding them just one language only, they can absorb it much quicker.
But if children can absorb a language quickly, theoretically, young children are able to pick up language, they have less inhibitions about it.
Yeah.
But yet, we pick this up. Mm-hmm. And we're old and dying, and we have inhibitions. Yes, we still pick it up. So, I'm just saying.
A lot of techniques
The bottom line is, if we don't expose the students to English, how else are they going to learn it? Now, at the school I'm at, when I first arrived, I thought, my gosh, there's a heck of a lot of Chinese spoken in English lessons. It's even in my world. And we then got the, every county gets the scores of how each grade is done, etc., particularly grade 9s. And the director, the academics director, came to me and said, listen, we're in trouble. Our English scores are very low. So she asked me now to come up with ideas. And one of the ideas I came up with is the development of a strategic plan for the English department. I don't know if other schools that you're at have a strategic plan for the English department on exactly how is English going to be implemented in the lessons, all those type of things. Do you have such strategic plans?
No, I wish that our co-teacher would you would check this down. So
okay. Well, very briefly, so I thought, well, let's develop a strategic plan, because your strategic plan is your compass. It tells you exactly where and how you're going to get to a particular destination. So, very briefly, we looked at what are the positives about the English department, what are the negatives, and what are the new things we could come up with. And of course, one that was really bugging me was the use of Chinese in our English classrooms. And so, in our strategic plan, we decided that when it comes to my lesson, it's 95% English. And the other 5%, I'll tell you where that comes from just now. For the other, where I'm not involved, it's 70%. Because often I would walk past classrooms, and not that I'm checking up on my colleagues, but you're here in an English lesson, just Chinese spoken. And again, I ask, how are the students supposed to speak English if they cannot hear it, if they're not exposed to it? So 70% for my co-teachers. Now, when it comes to my lessons, the co-teacher knows very little Chinese from her, I have females working with me. And it's to take place in the following way. If Chinese needs to be spoken, I ask the students, what is it in Chinese? Okay, so that's number one. I ask the students. And the co-teacher's listening out to see if that student is correct or not. The other one that I showed you earlier, I always love using images. Because images just give you so much more than words. And thirdly, I'm not sure if any of you have really thought about this, dictionaries, English-Chinese dictionaries. I found out in my school, every classroom has an English-Chinese dictionary, but no one was using it. So I said, well, bring all those dictionaries to my classroom. And dictionaries per group. And now the students have got accustomed to it now that if there's an English word, they don't ask me, they look it up in the dictionary. And there's a hell of a lot more skills coming out of that. So if you've got dictionaries, and even if I'm an English club after school, they can use it on the cell phone as well, get the kids to explore that word rather than just getting it from you. But what does work is the students translating it from English into Chinese. And very little input from my co-teachers. That works for me. You might think differently, it's entirely up to you. But the strategic plan was paramount in saying, this is how we're going to do it. And everyone took ownership within the English department of the strategic plan, and they all made sure that they came on board with it. So when we have new teachers coming into the English department, they themselves know exactly this is our plan. And every year we have to follow up on this. And I must admit, in the beginning, it was challenging for my colleagues. But now they know there is a level that they, or a line that they cannot cross for the sake of our students.
What was the challenge?
Because it was just so easy to use Chinese.
Just so easy. Then the foreigners to translate.
No. When they're teaching English in their own lessons, in their own classes. I only have what, 4 lessons a week of English. I only do 1 of them, but then the 3 are by my co-teachers themselves. Do you understand?
Yes.
They were just using so much. And it's a mind shift, but it works.
What was the percentage you agreed on for them to do in their class?
70. I think that's the, Melina, I think it's 70% set out by the MOE as well.
Yes, I mean the whole English, yes, that will be 70%. It's just including you play the CD, an English song, like anything that is in English, 70% in the whole class. But it also depends on what kind of content you are teaching. If it's a test, for the junior high school, if the teacher would like to talk about the testing thing, I think most of the time we will use Chinese. It will be much easier and faster to explain the grammar rules for junior high school. So it really depends on what content, what the lesson is about. But like the average, 70%.
Yeah, my colleagues are very confident in English, but often it's also a confidence problem for them as well. Okay. But now they're bought into the system. And yes, we have to review it every year, and it was challenging in the beginning. But now that we have it, it's on paper. Paper is also patient. We have to make sure that we implement it. Because it's not about us, it's about our student scores at the end of the day. There are 2 extra classes I give at my school. The one is for the upper level. I don't have a co-teacher. It's only me, themselves, and a dictionary. Okay. I also have a lower level group as well. Myself, them, and a dictionary. Because I'm pumping them with English. It's work that we have done previously, but I'm just reinforcing that particular lower level group on the English. It works. Get them using dictionaries. I mean, many of us here don't enjoy using a dictionary. I will often have a competition. Who can find the word for me impossible? And who can find it the quickest? Okay, those type of things. And then give me the Chinese. Okay, I want to hear how you say it in Chinese. Do we have those little fun things as well? Dictionaries, great fun. But a lot of us don't like to use them. Okay? White elephants. Sorry, okay. Okay, so direct translation, it's up to you. It works for me. But if they don't hear English, how can we expect them to speak it? That's the bottom line. They need exposure. Right, the next one is cultural. This is part of the kill. If you look at the textbooks, you'll see a lot of the content is focused on the USA. I have no objections to Americans, please. But the world is not just America. The world is all over.
It is, really.
Talk about the later part. But what I want to say is, how else are we able to inculcate in our students cultural awareness and cultural sensitivity? I come from a country where this is important stuff, okay? And I make sure that the students are also familiar with this as well. So I bring in a lot of other things, a lot of other countries. And that's where that world map comes in as well. We talk about the culture. We talk about the religious values. What is that in that country that's different to Taiwan? And I always bring it back to Taiwan. Do we do it? Yes or no? Or why not? Or why? Those type of things. So cultural sensitivity, cultural awareness. That's important, I think, in any English system. It comes back to the clue. Okay? Think about it. Broadens the student's horizons. And as I said, be culturally sensitive and respectful. So what's the student outcome? Now, I'm going to say this, and I was going to say it later on. Most of you possibly only teach a unit over 2 weeks. Am I correct? A unit over 2 weeks? 3 weeks. Okay, junior high to 2 weeks. Sorry?
How many classes is
that? Well, if you look at the textbook, it's semester one, it's 9 units. Okay? In other words, 9 different lessons, a unit. And a unit is over 2 weeks. Semester one.
But
and semester two.
You only see them?
I see them once a week.
So
at class, once a week. They have 4 classes a week. I only see them one of those 4. The other 3 are with the co-teachers. Okay, so a unit, a chapter, whatever you want to call it, over 2 weeks. Now, I've somehow arranged with my school, and if you look at some of the textbooks, some of those units are really, you want to pull your hair out. I'm not going to say anything else. So what I've asked my colleagues is, can I skip some of those units and focus on a longer duration for other units? They bought into that. Because for us, it's about getting the students to communicate. So sometimes, some of the units will be over 4 weeks. And if I've really got a lot of stuff that I can do, it's over 5 weeks. Very seldom, but generally it's 3 or 4 weeks. Okay? So in those 3 to 4 weeks, I've given them a lot of stuff. They also acquired it from my co-teachers as well in that lesson, or the 3 lessons that they did on that particular unit as well. And then I'm able to give them assessment. Okay? And this is important because at the end of the day, it's all about scores. But it's how you do it. So I look at simple things like role play. Have any of you thought about getting your students to design PowerPoints? They love it. They love it. Okay? And they can come up with the wackiest of PowerPoints. But they all have to, in that group, contribute towards that PowerPoint presentation in English. Posters, problem solving, research surveys, create their own songs. I did a simple one the other day, please, my voice is hopeless when it comes to singing. Even one of my co-teachers said, Phil, stop, I'll sing it. But you know, it's that simple one in the present continuous tense, what are you doing, I'm sleeping, what are you doing, I'm walking. Then get them to make their own songs using the present continuous with that rhythm melody as well. I heard some fabulous ones. I thought at that moment I'm going to assess them as well. Because it was just so great. Action going on, singing, etc. Thankfully, my co-teacher was able to raise it a notch higher than what I could sing. Combination of any of the above, or let the students decide. I don't have enough of that. So let me just show you. And by the way, Thursday, when Lena and I are teaching, you're going to see with the PowerPoints that I'm going to be presenting, how the students will be able to take it from their onwards as well. So, I mean, this is just showing you some of the students that present something. And they all participate. What's the other one that I want to talk about? Okay, I'll get to those just now. Sorry. Art activities. I cannot draw to save my life. But if your strength is art, apply it in your lessons. My son, he came to Taiwan. I love telling this story. He came to Taiwan in January during winter vacation, and he could teach at our school because he's studying to be an English teacher as well. And I know art's his strength, and he walked into the classroom, he didn't introduce himself. just took a piece of chalk and he started drawing something on a chalkboard. And those kids were gobsmacked. They were just watching him. He could really draw very, very well. Until he found out that one of the other students in his class could also draw very well. But he used that as his strength. So if music is your strength, then use it. If it's art, go for it. That's what CLIL stands for. Bring it into your classroom. So art allows for rich vocabulary input and output. Vocab, such as adjectives, adverbs, all those type of things, allows them to engage in another culture. But also, art is something tangible. You can feel it, you can hold it, you can touch it, you can see it. Okay? Now, if you look, for instance, in your manual at that task, this was designed around superlatives and degrees of comparison. I would never tell the students these words, superlatives and degrees of comparison. I would say to them, I want you to read this, and I want you to draw what you read. Okay? And this is what one of them came up with. Well, she was absolutely great. Okay? That's what she could come up with, based on what she could read coming out of this. So, what do I often do? I do this. I love giving the students mind maps. But I break it up into various categories. I will tell them the story. I say to them, now, when I tell you the story, I want you to draw it. Okay? And I will repeat it a couple of times, a few times if I have to, depending on the class. Draw what I tell you. Right, and they've done that. Right, task number two. I want you to tell each other in Chinese what you have drawn. Make sure they're on the same page. Make sure that they have understood what I have told them. And then once I've done that, then I say to them, right now I want you to tell each other in your English what you have drawn. Works. In your English. In other words, with all its mistakes and everything else that follows from it. Okay? The main thing is, they have understood the message. Listening skills. Theme collages, I must admit, I've done it once. Maybe you could do it better. Handcraft activities. Those are tough things. We did this with Valentine's Day. Great thing. Okay. The kids love it. Okay? They love doing the arty things. Because there's a lot of kids who are visually capable of doing this. I can't do it. I'm hopeless. Okay? Give me something with data, statistics. That's my field. But art, not my strength. Even less so music. But there are students who want this. They want it. Now, this for me was the flavor of the year. I had such fun looking for it, and I had such fun presenting it to the students. And they break themselves to laugh. So long as it's around your theme, the context. And it's as close as you'll get to the real thing. Nothing beats it. Often describes more than what words can ever express. It's again, it's the same as images. Integrates the outside world to the classroom. Because a lot of my kids in my school have never been outside of Hsinchu County. Now I'm taking them beyond, taking them outside Taiwan. It engages students and stimulates a wealth of activities. Now I want to show you a couple now. The first one, cultural differences, actually cultural misunderstandings, and then table manners. Maybe some of you already know it. Cultural misunderstanding. Tom Selleck, my hero.